Good morning, all you bright, sunshiny people, you. Welcome to week two of The Ship is Sinking and Bill's the Captain, or Easter 4, as we call it. Welcome to joint worship services of McDougal United Church and Ogden United Church. Reverend Joanne is still on sabbatical, although she's doing a really miserable job of being on sabbatical because she did attend Chinook Winds regional meeting over the past several days. So she started her sabbatical with work, but still, who am I to judge? A few announcements as we start our worship this morning. First off, it says, Happy Mother's Day. So after worship, I have to go purchase some stuff. Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers or folks who have been mothering. If you are a young minister in the church, you started off as a young youth minister in the church, especially at this church, you have a lot of mothers. Or people who think they're your mother. Are you going to wear the black? Are you really going to wear the black T-shirt and jeans, really? I don't care if all your friends are wearing T-shirt and jeans. If they all jumped off a bridge, would you jump off a bridge? But here we are. Happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers out there and folks who take care of really failed comedians like myself. Second announcement, fun script deadline is fast approaching. The deadline is, I think, today, actually, the second Sunday of each month for folks in McDougal. FunScript is a program where you can purchase gift cards and the church is rewarded for doing so. There's lots of different companies. You can visit the website or speak to the church office if you would like more information. But today is the deadline to put in your May orders for that. Secondly, after I announced it last week, there were some folks who stepped up and volunteered to help out with coffee, but we still need more because you folks drink coffee a lot. Like every Sunday, you drink coffee. And so we still need more folks who would be willing to help out over the summer with volunteering to just come in before the service and set up coffee so that it is ready for after the service. The work is entirely done prior to the service starting, so you won't need to miss out on anything. It takes just a couple of people. It's fairly easy, work to do. It's not laborious in any way, shape, or form. So if you are around and available and are willing to help out with setting up coffee, please just contact the church office and get your names on the list. Also, Nick is here. Nick Sloat, if you want to stand up, everybody. Nick Sloat, meet everybody. They're clapping because you're Nick. For those who don't know, Nick is the Ambrose internship student that will be starting here in June, starting here on June the 1st here at McDougal. He's actually starting now in a position just helping Dana out with the children's ministry up until June 1st starts. So you will start to see him around now. He gave me a really his self-written bio. So here we go. Nick has sensed a draw to pastoral ministry since he was in his early teens back in the small town of Barrhead. And nobody told him, beware that call. First studying chemical engineering, he eventually ended up moving to Calgary to study theology at Ambrose University. During that time in between, Nick worked in several different types of jobs, from retail at Williams-Sonoma to sales at Coca-Cola, as well as various labor positions. Through all of these jobs, he learned the hard way not to ignore it when God calls you to ministry. His driving force in ministry is to work with youth, guiding them into the mystery and love of Christ, and teaching them practical life skills to help them thrive in their lives. Nick is the father of two incredible yet chaotic kids, Asher, age 5, and Jude, age 3. My condolences. Minoring in theater, Nick loves the performing arts and tries to see live local plays at least 3 times every year. He is also an avid reader, so if you are looking for a recommendation on topics such as racism, patriarchy, colonialism, queer theology, biblical scholarship, or autism, Nick would love to recommend a good book for you to read. He doesn't really read fiction, though, so you'll be disappointed if you ask for that. Dun, dun, dun. Nick and I need to have a conversation. Nick is looking forward to building meaningful community and relationships at McDougal. Let me know if my bio needs any fine-tuning. Thanks, Nick. Nick did not sign up to show up on a Sunday that Bill was preaching. So everybody, Nick is here now. He'll be here for the duration of this month. His internship will start at the beginning of June, and then he will be here to long enough that you'll forget that there was ever a time that he wasn't here, really, after that, is how it's going to work. So welcome, Nick. Good luck, and I promise I won't do that to you again. And finally, I have it on relatively good authority, and I'm going to need Tanya to be ready and Randy to be ready. I have it on relatively good authority that Marg Heidebrecht, the woman who stands at the back pretty much every Sunday, hands out bulletins to folks as they come in, greets everybody, is kind of that first person who's smiling at you when you walk in the door, is turning 85 tomorrow. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mark. Happy birthday to you. That's the only way you get away with finding out how old someone, or how old somebody is turning, or asking how old they are. Sing happy birthday afterwards. All right. That's all I have for announcements. Are there any others? Because you never know. All right. Then I'm going to invite us all, as we are able, to stand and let's sing our opening hymn, Who is My Mother? Seated. The church, the community of God's people, the followers of the way of Jesus. We talk a lot about being a family. And we all know that in any good family, there are those who nurture us, those who care for us and celebrate who we are, regardless of whether we are struggling or succeeding, whether we are good or bad. They see past the dualities, they see past the moments to the core of who we are and who we truly are. And so on a day such as Mother's Day, it would make sense for us to look at our community, at our family, and to consider anew those who nurture us in our faith, those who nurture us in our living, and the image of one God, mother of us all, that holds us all in care and compassion all the days of our life. And so we light this candle as a symbol of this community of Christ, as a symbol of the presence of Christ in us and among us. And we pray that that light might shine even brighter this morning as we gather. Amen. How do you follow that? Oh, let's just take that feeling with us into our time of prayer. Let's just breathe in the joy and hold it. And friends, as we pray, I will say the parts that are printed in yellow and invite you to respond with the parts that are printed in black. Let us pray. Oh God, we pray for all the diverse beauty of households created and blessed by your love. We thank you for old family photographs and precious memories of loved ones, for the ability to dream dreams and for the wisdom to interpret them. We thank you for relationships that grow dearer with time, for the laughter and the stories that bind us together.
We thank you for good friends and new ideas,
for all that the future will hold, and for the confidence and hope to envision it.
We are called to be the church, the family of Christ in every age.
Today we renew our commitment to one another and to the journey we share.
And so, friends, as we gather all of our prayers and that are spoken with all of our prayers that are unspoken and held in our hearts, I would invite you to stop for a moment and just think. Think of one person who in the course of your life has been a nurturer for you, that has nurtured you in your growth from childhood to adulthood, from doubt to faith, from struggle to comfort to perhaps even success. But one person who has carried you and built you up, and bring that individual with you alongside all of our prayers into the one prayer that Jesus taught us as we sing. No matter who you are and what your story is, you are welcome in this place, and you are loved by God. This is the promise of God, the good news of the gospel, that whatever faults or failings, whatever times you have tripped or stumbled, whatever obstacles you have had difficulty surpassing, God picks you up. God sets your feet back on the path. And you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so I'm going to invite you all to stand as you are able. Just stand if you are able. Everybody looks at me every time. He's making a stand. Something's about to happen. Dun, dun, dun. We normally, pre-pandemic, would have wandered around now and shook each other's hands and hugged each other and done all that stuff and passed the peace of Christ. We are not yet there yet where we are able to do that with safety for the most vulnerable in our community. So we have ritualized the passing of the peace into a simple gesture of bringing our hands to our hearts like this and saying, "Peace of Christ be with you." And then extending them out to the world and each other and saying, "And also with you." So peace of Christ be with you, and also with you. I invite you to turn and pass the peace of Christ to each other from your seats. And so, friends, as we enter into our time of the prayers of the people, I would invite you to consider any concerns or cares that you need to lift up to God and to hold them close as we sing together our prayer song, "Lord, Listen to Your Children Praying." We will sing, then pray, then sing, then pray. You'll get the idea. Just follow along as we go.
Lord, listen.
God of light and love, we give you thanks for this day. For the beauty of the warmth of the sun on our face and the beauty of the changing of the seasons. For all that is green and growing. The sound of birds. The smell of the moisture in the morning. We see the wonder and awe of your creation all around us. And how can we not say thank you for your abundance? The abundance of color and beauty around us, the abundance of provision in our lives. We are grateful, O God, for the hearts and the hands of so many in our community of faith, in our community around us, in our friends and our family. We need not look far to see your grace reflected in the eyes and the smile of someone we love. God, we pray for all of those who may be experiencing loneliness, sadness and grief, loss. Even in our gratitude, we know that you know the total experience of human life, O God. That in the joys and in the sorrows, you are with us. Not as an observer, but walking with us, bearing us up, helping us to continue to stand and giving us the strength and the endurance to persevere. We see your support reflected in the support of those around us. And we pray that you would help us to reflect that love and that support to those we know in our lives. And so we commend into your care those people we know who are struggling. Those who are grieving. Those who are suffering. Ask for you to draw close to them and to hold them in your loving embrace. God, we pray for those around the world who live in the shadow of violence and oppression, those living in fear of war and tyranny. Those without food, those without access to clean water, we know that this world is not a reflection of your love for all your people, O God. And so we sing.
Lord, listen to your children pray.
God, when we look at the headlines, we see the brokenness of our world. And so we pray today for world leaders, people with power, that they might resist the temptation to nationalism or greed or selfishness, that they may look with new hearts and new eyes to find new ways of seeking peace and upholding the common good of all. And God, we pray for your church the world over, including us here in our small corner of the world. Help us to hear your call to justice and action. Help us to love our neighbors. Help us to love our enemies. Help us to see beyond our own self-interest, our own self-preservation, to the exciting and dynamic movement of your Spirit in the world, calling us to new places, calling us to the places of hardship and struggle, to abide there, to serve there, to be there. God, we stand in awe of your love for us. And we pray that in our words and in our actions, we might be the image of that love and that grace in the world. Where there is brokenness, help us bring healing. So we sing. And our prayers to you, with gratitude that we can trust that you are with us in every stage and every phase of our lives. God's people said, Amen.
Amen. I'm reading today from Luke chapter 8, verses 43 to 48. As Jesus moved along, the crowd almost crushed him. In the crowd was a woman who had suffered from hemorrhages for 12 years and had found no one who could heal her. She came up behind Jesus and touched the fringe of his cloak, and immediately the bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. And when no one nearby responded, Peter said, "Rabbi, it's the crowd pressing around you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I felt power leave me." When the woman realized she'd been noticed, she approached in fear and knelt before him. She explained in front of the crowd why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Jesus said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." May we find meaning for today in this ancient story.
Going on record that I'm getting a little tired of following the musicians. Last week we started Joanne's sabbatical. Last week we talked about the fact that we were going to spend the next several weeks while Joanne was on sabbatical reminding ourselves of what it is that we hopefully come to church for, what it is that we find when we are here, and what it is to be a church and a community of faith in the time that we are in. And that is no small task to do, but I've been messing around a bit with the idea that we might need to call this vitamin C, of all things, because it's good to take vitamin C, right? I take my vitamin C every morning, as much because I have three little biological warfare children that are currently spreading the plague, not COVID, but the seasonal plague throughout my house as it is, and I am trying to remain well. But I noticed, and maybe by some intention, that all of the words that I've chosen for the next several weeks begin with C. Last week we talked about community. This week we're talking about calling. And yes, all the rest of them are C's as well, but I'm not going to tell you what they are now because I want you to come back. And if you read some of them, you're like, oh, that's going to be a boring one. I'm not coming for that one. Come and be bored. But calling in the church, when we talk about calling in the community of God's people, we talk about it in a certain way that certainly is very accurate. I would say that I, as a minister, am called to the ministry of word, sacrament, and pastoral care. That's the sort of formal wording that we use in the United Church for ordination. I am called to the ministry of word, preaching, sacrament, communion, baptism, and pastoral care. Visiting people in their homes and having them make me really tasty sweet treats and pour tea, and we sit around and we chat about stuff while I get fat and lazy. And when we talk about calling for the Christian community, we are called to seek justice. Or even in our new creed, we say we are called to be the church, and then we list a number of different callings of the church to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, to live with respect in creation. These are all callings of Christian community. But I want us to think about a different kind of calling, because a lot of people can spend their lifetimes trying to discern what their calling is from a perspective of what it is that you are called to do. I am wondering if anybody has thought about what it is that you are called to be. Let me give you an example. My wife, I'm biased, but my wife is the best mother. And I'll tell you why. She, with each of our kids, proclaimed on day one when we named them, this is going to be their name. Not any of those nicknames. This is going to be their name. So our first daughter was Kathleen, right? She said she's not going to be Kate. She's not going to be Katie. She's not going to be Kathy. She's going to be Kathleen. Those of you who know my children will know that she has been, and for a number of years, Katie, regardless. Second daughter was named Bethany, right? Again, she's not going to be Beth. She's not going to be Betty. She's not going to be any of these. She's going to be Bethany. My daughter is starting to make the transition right now as we speak into wanting to be called Beth. And James. Good old James. In fact, Joanne, the minister here at McDougal, joked in front of my wife when we had named our son James, "Oh, so he's going to be little Jimmy then." And I thought my wife was going to kill her right here in the church under the cross with Jesus watching. She will, and she very, very adamantly, he will never be a Jimmy. Now, he's not Jimmy. But he is, get ready for this, when my wife talks to him, Jamesy. Jamesy, right? When I watch my kids get called their E names by my wife, they melt. I call my son Jamesy. He looks at me like something really weird and sinister is happening. We tested it one time. I sat him down and I said, and my wife could not stop laughing. I sat him down and I said, "You know, Jamesy, I'm really proud of all the work you did in cleaning your room. You did a very good job, and I'm very, very, very happy." And he looked at me in terror, absolute terror, because he had no idea what was coming or what to expect. We tested it 2 weeks later with my wife doing it, and he lit up. My wife is the nurturer in our house. I'm the hammer of God. I'm the don't make me send your father up there to deal with you guys. I have the look. My wife has the names. I was reading a story, or an anecdotal story, I guess, by in a book called Tattoos on the Heart that was written by Gregory Boyle. He's a Jesuit priest who started Homeboy Industries, it's called. It started off as a ministry of a church for Latin gang members in California. And their ministry started off very much tattoo removal and employment opportunities and those kinds of things to really just kind of get gang members to consider leaving the lifestyle. And he was talking about a particular gang member that he was dealing with, just trying to get his name. You know, just met him for the first time, said, "What's your name?" And he said, "Oh, they call me Sniper. They call me Sniper." He's like, "Okay, yeah, I get it, but I'm pretty sure that's not what your mother calls you, right?" And they went through this cycle of, "Oh, well, my mother calls me idiot, right?" And then, "Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's not actually what your mother calls you, right? Well, she calls me tough guy, or she calls me handsome, or she calls me," right? And he finally said, "Like, what's on your birth certificate? What is your name on your birth certificate?" He said, "Okay, on my birth certificate, it's actually Napoleon." Legitimately, it was Napoleon, right? And he said, "Okay, well, now we're getting somewhere. That is a very strong, you know, kind of empirical, powerful name. That's a name with history. That's a name that commands respect," right? He said, "But I'm pretty sure that's not what your mom actually calls you," right? And he described the process of watching the layers strip away from this tough guy gang member, this gangbanger on the streets, until he finally said, sometimes, my mother would call me Napito, Little Napoleon, like a cutie kind of a name, right? And then he started to cry. I was telling the story to a friend of mine who's Spanish as well, who's Mexican, and I said, "Like, I'm curious. Like, what did your mom call you when you were a kid?" And she always called me Mijo, which is son, right? But like the son doesn't really communicate it properly, right? It's son, but in like the dear one kind of sense of the word, right? That there's a relational, loving, a vulnerable connection when you say it. In our gospel today, we're told the story of a woman who has suffered her entire life with an affliction. And depending on the version of the scripture that you read, they'll even go so far as to tell you that the translation says that she has paid to have people heal her and they can't. In our scripture version today, she just says nobody's been able to help. And she has it in her head. She has this idea that maybe, just maybe, if she could just even touch Jesus, that maybe he could heal her from this affliction that has plagued her for her entire life. And so she does. She presses through the crowd, she touches Jesus, and she is healed. And Jesus immediately says, "Who touched me?" And they say, "It's just the crowd pressing in on you." He says, no, I know that somebody touched me because I felt some of my power leave me. I felt that somebody was healed in this moment when they touched me. Who was it that touched me?" And eventually she stands before this crowd, and he says, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Daughter, your faith has made you well." We talk a lot in church about God calling us beloved, God calling us children, but all of us calling each other part of our family. And our scripture today reminds us that even Jesus, pressed in by a crowd, calls this woman daughter. But again, the translation's a little fuzzy on daughter. It doesn't communicate directly in the same way. This isn't just simply a birth certificate kind of name that Jesus is calling her. There's compassion in this translation of daughter. There's relationship. There's depth. I heard a quote one time that said, "We all just want to be called." I'm scanning the room really quickly here to make sure that there aren't any young ears, because I'm going to say the quote as it was said. "We all just want to be called the name that our mothers called us, that our mother calls us when she's not pissed at us. We all just want to be called the name that our mother calls us when she's not pissed at us." You know the other name, right? The triple name? You know what I'm talking about? William Ryan Weaver. Come here, please. I know what that meant. That was also my mother's name for me. But the name she called me when she was not angry at me. That is what Jesus is calling this woman. In daughter. That's what it is to be a child of God. That is the love of God. In a single word, it is the name you were called when your mother was not angry with you. Do you remember that name? I remember mine. I'm not telling you. It's too embarrassing. But if my mother were to call me now, even, I would bawl like a 3-year-old. Oh, man. That is the name that God calls you even now. That is the name that God calls you even in the midst of the worst of your struggles. I can remember when Katie was young. She was in preschool. She was in preschool and they were doing their Christmas concert and they had practiced their Christmas carols and parents just had to show up, sit in chairs, and they were gonna sing 5 Christmas carols and then the concert was gonna be over. It was gonna be quick, 20 minutes, we were gonna be done. We had grandparents come, we had friends of the family come, it was our first kid, we did it all upright. James, poor James, we didn't even invite anybody else. But for Katie, we did it. The first kid always, right, gets all that attention. And we had everybody there, and Katie freaked right out and hid in the bathroom for the entire concert, crying the entire time, and would not come out and sing. And when I finally found out where they had all disappeared to, my wife and my daughter were in that bathroom. She was sitting in my daughter's lap, or my daughter was sitting in my wife's lap, rather, weird image otherwise, and she was rocking back and forth on the floor of the bathroom, and she was saying, "Everything will be okay," and Katie had just melted into her. Fast forward to grade 1, when the school concert was going to happen. Their winter concert was going to happen. And Katie had been practicing, and she was so anxious, and she was so worried, and she was so petrified about the prospect of having to sing. And not only sing, but because of where they were in the concert and what was going on, she had to be standing in the front row to sing her song from memory, and she was terrified. And I watched every single night as Katie and my wife practiced and practiced and practiced and practiced. And I gave her all the coaching tips, you know, like they say, picture everybody naked, or whatever the case may be. Like, do whatever it is you have to do to not be anxious. But it was my wife that did the work, right? I just gave the advice. And when push came to shove, we got there. She stood up, dressed as a snowflake. She sang every single word confidently in the front row all the way through. And the funniest thing was, I was bawling like a three-year-old watching it happen, and my wife was grinning from ear to ear. And when all of it was done, my daughter came out from her class, and my wife was on her knees in front of her and just said, "Katie," and like just wrapped her in this huge hug. And like they cried together, and it was fantastic. It was beautiful. My wife had been with her through the entire struggle and was there at the end of it all. And I knew then more than ever before exactly what it means when God calls me son, when God calls you daughter, when God calls you whatever that name is that God calls you, that reminds you of that moment when your mom is not angry at you. The challenge of that call, the challenge of being called that name, is that as people who follow Jesus, as people who proclaim the God that we worship, we also need to call others by those same kind of names. And that is missing in our world right now. We have forgotten how to call people the loving names. We have forgotten how to call people the names that inspire, that warm us. We've turned so much to political discourse, name-calling, us and them, divisive language, all those dark, insidious kind of things that are taking root in our society. It's making it harder for us to remember that at the end of it all, we are all people who simply want to be called by the name that our mom calls us when she's not pissed at us. Not just by God, but by each other. Do you remember your name? Do you know anybody else's? I've got a cool little experiment here. I just thought of this. This is what we're going to do. I told him I'd never do it to him again. I'm going to lie. Bonus points to whoever finds out what Nick's name was. Nick, the new guy that just started today. If you can find out what his mom called him when she wasn't angry at him, we'll give you bonus points. They're worth nothing. We'll do Whose Line Is It Anyway bonus points. But there's an introduction to congregational ministry. Do you remember what your mom called you when she wasn't mad at you? Maybe it wasn't your mom. But each and every one of us at least has somebody who has probably been the person who raised them, cared for them, loved them unconditionally, loved them in the times of the struggle, loved them in the times of succeeding, loved them in the times of absolutely abject failing. If you want to know what it is like to be a child of God, what it means to be a child of God, remember that feeling. Remember that feeling of what my children know as their mother's love. Whatever that person is for you, whomever that person is for you, most important of all, remember that name. That is the name that God calls you every single day. That is the name to listen for when you're talking with God. God loves you. God always has. And God always will, and calls you by name. Daughter, son, Napito, mijo, Pookie. Thanks be to God. Amen. And like I planned it, I'm going to invite you all to stand and let us sing, "I Have Called You by Your Name." all beloved children of God, and go out into this day and into this week trusting in that God loves you. God loves you at your worst. God loves you at your best. God calls you by name. God calls you the name that your mom calls you when she's not angry at you. Go out and love others as God loves you. For that will truly change the world. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all. Amen.